Y siente runga, rey.
Good morning, everyone. We'll be starting shortly. Good morning, everyone, and thank you all for joining us from your various parts, from your various locations, sorry, whether you're tuned in from Fiji, the Pacific, or the Pacific region. Your time is valuable, and we thank you for choosing to spend it here with us this morning. On behalf of International ID's Regional Office for Asia and the Pacific, I would like to welcome you all to the fifth webinar of the Democratic Development in Melanesia Webinar Series 2023. We would also like to welcome our panelists and especially you, our participants. As part of International IDEA's Asia and Pacific Regional Programs Work Plan for 2023, these webinars aim to provide opportunities to citizens of the Melanesian region to take part in substantive discussions surrounding democracy in Melanesia. It is also intended that through the webinars, citizens of Melanesian countries who participate may gain knowledge on the subject matter and on the experiences of other countries. This will in turn enhance debates on institutional and procedural improvements in their respective democracies. Now, this webinar, the fifth in its series, is titled International Day of Democracy: Empowering the Next Generation. The International Day of Democracy is observed annually on the 15th of September, or today, and is an opportunity to reflect and advocate for better democratic practices, for greater observance and respect for human rights by government officials, ministries, independent bodies, and for stakeholders especially. This year's theme is Empowering the Next Generation, which is focused on the important contribution children and young people make in protecting democracy today and in the future. To discuss this theme, International IDEA's Fiji office, in partnership with the Citizens Constitutional Forum of Fiji, with their project donor, Izirio, is hosting this webinar. So thank you very much. And we'd like to hear about the work of young people who are actively involved in raising issues at national and international levels. At the moment, Fiji performs in the mid-range across all categories of the Global State of Democracy framework, although performance and representation, rights, and rule of law are at the lower end of this band. It is among the world's top 25% in electoral participation and civil society, but has suffered from declines in social group equality. This webinar will discuss the work of CCF with International IDEA and Miziroa and empowering young people through their community education programs, where young people are informed about their rights, responsibilities, and the functioning of democracy. Now, education is a powerful tool for empowering young people and fostering their active engagement in democratic processes. Achieving the SDGs requires the collective effort of all segments of society, including children and young people. When they are empowered through education and participation, they can actively contribute to the pursuit of these global goals, fostering a more sustainable and equitable world for everyone. Now, it is going to be an exciting webinar, and I, for one, cannot wait to hear from our speakers. But before we get started, as always, there are a few house rules. Now, this webinar will have three speakers who will deliver their presentations first, and then the audience can ask their questions after the speakers have presented. To do this, members of the audience can use the raise hand feature to ask questions, which is located at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Now, the audience is reminded to keep their mic off during the webinar and to only turn it on when asking questions. However, if your mic is not working, you can pose your questions through the chat feature. Now, before we proceed any further, please note that this session is being recorded. And as with all webinars, with International IDEA, I have a disclaimer that I am required to read out, and it reads: The statements, views, or opinions expressed in the presentation do not necessarily represent the institutional position of International IDEA, its board of advisors, or its Council of Member States. Now, if you haven't already done so, I'd like to humbly request that everyone put their mics on mute as I introduce our first speaker for today, Ms. Vinyana Thakau. Ms. Vinyana Thakau is from Natilambau in the province of Tailevu and is the Citizens Constitutional Forum's Community Program Director and has been with CCF's Community Education Team for 13 years. She has had human rights capacity building with Diplomacy Training Program, a UNSW, which has helped her in carrying out advocacy education with communities on human rights, the 2013 Constitution, good governance, active citizenship, and the rights-based approach to development. She's also a fellow with the Kettering Foundation Dayton, Ohio, with the Deliberative Democracy Institute program, which has also built her knowledge and capacity in encouraging and promoting democratic practices, especially community participation in government spaces. Ladies and gentlemen, our first speaker for this morning, Ms. Vinyana Thakau.
The CCF Community Education Program has been working with communities since the year 2009, mainly awareness and advocacy on areas of human rights, good governance, active citizenship, constitution, and the rights-based approach to development. We work with community leaders, women and women community groups, also youth and youth individual groups. We also work with local level institutions who are usually the gatekeepers, our main departments in working with communities. I'll briefly mention some observations from the workshop we have had and are funded from our previous project, also the ones that we are having now. What we have found that the issues and challenges of youth are similar. In relation to youth interest and youth participation, whether they be community-related activities that require their presence and participation, or government consultations and activities that also seek youth participation and community-related interest. In terms of participating in national activities like elections, some responses from youth that were part of our workshop that had registered to vote, only a few voted in the recent 2020 election. In relation to human rights, the elderly in most of our workshops mentioned that most human rights abuses in communities are badly used. Issues like drinking and disorderly manner in the community, not upholding community structures and the dynamics. Children who are supposed to be in school and are within the age group below 18 refuse to attend school and be banned eventually outside it is their right. There are criminal activities like burglary, housebreaking, trespassing, and maximum use of drugs. Some communities do not have youth-related programs specifically specified or to enhance their basic skills, whereas other communities have youth programs specifically funded, but do not have markets to market the program. With a few communities, permission to access services that are made available for use from the relevant people. As a result, they are usually left to fend for themselves. What we have observed is that most youth, these are also from the country, most youth are unemployed. They are seldom consulted and are demotivated because of their weakness to engage effectively. Because of this, they are not empowered to be part of the listening for community people. Youth are usually not acknowledged as their contribution to community people. From this contribution, some lessons we have learned from the collective care are, I start on the positive side, on the good part of the strength, that youth do have strength, but those strengths are self-managed. Youth have the capacity to live if they are limited now, at an earlier stage. Youth have the potential to be leaders and to develop individual citizens of Fiji and their communities. Youth still need guidance. They still need guidance and motivation. If we are to have a generation that will recognize democracy and uphold the practices and principles of democracy starting from their communities. Youth need to be consulted and encouraged to complete their education, pursue further educational initiatives, and a well-guided career path. Youth, when engaged, show a developing interest and are keen to understand the information that is imparted. I'm talking about content of our workshop. Because the content of our workshop are mainly on human rights, good governance, the 2013 Constitution, the Bill of Rights. So when they start to learn, when we share information on these things, they show an interest. There is a great need for more community-based engagement, and this engagement would be on health awareness, basic life skills training by the relevant stakeholders, leadership training, basic legal literacy. For interfaith villages, the Vanua strengthening of traditional knowledge and skills to help them out, and skills based professional training. Some of the highlights we have had because before going into communities, we work with our stakeholders and mostly they are the interfaith board or the provincial officers. The district officer and some civil society have a collaborative way of approaching our communities to engage communities effectively in good mood. By working together, inclusive platforms in the community are developed to ensure that youth have a say in decisions that affect them, especially in community development and in shaping their community. One main approach in empowering youth to participate in democratic processes is in the stages of involvement and engagement that build their confidence was founded on knowledge base in our workshop. So, for this, I mean, formulate the fact that okay, not free on me. So I think I'm on the front of the on the trip I
I apologize for that interruption. Much better. The CCF Community Education Team works with development partners, mainly the ITEB provincial offices, district offices, and some civil societies, as a collaborative way of approaching to engage communities, including youth. By working together, we have provided inclusive platforms in communities that are developed to ensure that youths have a say in decisions that affect them, especially in community development and in shaping their communities. One main approach that CCF has used in empowering youth to participate in democratic processes in the stages of involvement and engagement, because we believe when they are engaged, this builds their confidence, which is founded on knowledge gained in the workshops and the consistent and continuous engagement that we hold with the community youths. The youths are identified in the community workshops. We have stages of engagement for youth in our workshops. We first identify how they participate and they interact in community workshops, and then they are invited to various forums and symposiums organized by CCF, as this provides them the opportunities to share their perspectives, learn from experts and their peers, and contribute to discuss important community and national issues. This approach has given them the confidence. The elders responsibly. When I'm talking about standing boldly, I'm talking about how they are responsible in articulating their rights. And in those platforms that they are invited to. But there are a few challenges. Even though they are gaining knowledge, they are standing boldly, they are getting the confidence, they are gaining confidence, there are still challenges for youth participation that we have discovered through our workshops are the lack of awareness. Youths are not aware of the opportunities available for their growth, and they will not know on how, and they do not know on how to get involved, as information is not made available or is not passed down from them from the relevant institutions. Lack of resources. There are a lot of limitations to access markets if they are farmers, if they are farming in the communities, when they need to market their produce, markets are not available. There's no proper transportation in terms of access roads to their farms. There's none of this available. So this sort of diminishes the idea of self-sustainability on agriculture and to pursue sustainability on the basic skills. And limited decision-making power. Youths feel unvalued in decision-making process, and this may discourage their engagement. They are also, because this is sort of built on negative stereotypes and generational gaps, some adults hold negative views, assuming that youths are incapable or aren't interested to engage, which hinders their involvement and engagement. There are no support networks for mentorship and guidance, especially in informal settlements. We've just had workshops lately in informal settlements here in Suva and in the Western Division. What we have observed is because of the networks that are not available for youth, they are left idle and then they involve themselves in criminal activities. They youths need mentorship and guidance. They still need this. So they can navigate community engagement opportunities, capacity building, a career path and employment. These youths continually face additional barriers due to systematic inequalities and lack of representation. The existing rigid structures that do not prioritize youth engagement makes it difficult for youths to participate. And to bring it back to communities and back home, there is always a weak family and community structure that youths can always fall back on in times of dire need. There is no strong family structure back at home. A way forward would be to encourage community leaders to engage youths in taking up minor leadership roles or to be included in community committees for community development so they are directly involved in decision-making processes. In terms of policies, the relevant ministry should review their approach on existing programs that is geared towards youth development, preferably to have a holistic approach. To decentralize and set up support networks in the community rather than in institutions where youths are invited to be part of. There needs to be a collaborative approach from all stakeholders to have a holistic approach rather than working in silos. To realize the importance of a bottom-up approach rather than assuming what works for them, because the contexts are different in all youth groups. We need to understand the dynamics before putting together programs. What works for young people in the villages and in the maritime may not work for those in the informal settlements and peri-urban areas. There is a need to bridge the generational gap, but to do that, approaches have to be realistic that not only youths are part of, but also the older generation. Resources and information need to be made available where youths can easily link their strength and be nurtured through the programs. Few notable differences we have noted between those in rural and peri-urban areas since we work across communities, not only in grassroots communities in villages, but we also work in peri-urban areas. For rural areas, they have existing strong structures supported by family, the matangali or clans, the church and the vanua, which the culture, tradition, faith, and the bond as a village and identity that links them to the land, their family, the clan, their way of life. They have the elders that preserve those structures. You know, like the elders are the watchdog and the keepers of the structure that's in place. The youths are more mobilized in the rural areas. Youth groups are registered. That's what we have seen. In our workshops, as soon as we identify a youth group, we ask, have you been registered? And they said, they're registered. They have youth programs running. And youths are also tasked. They're already tasked with leadership roles, especially for village development. The elders are only there to guide and remind the youth of what needs to be done. Like there is an understanding between the elders and the youths. In most rural areas, most youths are well behaved and have become independent. They build their own homes from income they earn from farming and support their family from toiling the land or from fishing. Democratic principles that exist in most rural, they are democratic principles and it's in existence in most rural settings. So it's quite easy to link these existing principles to the desired democratic principles. Now for the peri-urban areas, there is a vast difference. First of all, in behavior and the interactions, it sticks out like a sore thumb. You can easily tell because of the way they interact and behave towards one another. There is no respect. There is a big gap in trying to mobilize youths because there isn't an existing structure that holds them together. Youths are from different backgrounds, especially family structures and the community dynamics. In one of our workshops in the peri-urban areas that we've just had, one of the youth that presented mentioned, in our community, we are from different villages living here. So we decide how we live our lives, and no one should be telling us what to do. This alone sums up the difference between rural and the peri-urban setting and the dynamics it has. So when the youth voice that they should not be told what to do, it tells us that there are no democratic principles in place, no support networks, and the workshop we are having for the first time with them should not be the last, but an intervention that needs to be continuous. Some of the gaps that need to be addressed that we have identified are lack of awareness. So we need to maximize community awareness and civic education on human rights in rural communities and mostly peri-urban areas, especially on right to access information. There is no collective approach amongst stakeholders. Collaborative approaches in terms of resources, especially information from all stakeholders made available for civic education, should complement one another to address the gap. Digital platforms for peri-urban areas and those accessible to digital information should be set up. There should be community centers or networks for information dissemination in rural villages. There is also lack of data, as these can be used as case studies to enhance understanding. Efforts should also be made to ensure that communities' needs are addressed in the civic education curriculum. I guess the aim of maximizing and raising awareness is to identify injustice and promote peace. And this is relevant to individual lives and in the community, also the potential benefits of achieving them. Another gap that we have identified is there is limited capacity for civic engagement. I am not sure of other organizations apart from the relevant ministry that promotes SDG 16, but capacity building on advocacy skills to enable people to effectively participate in decision-making processes and contribute to peaceful and inclusive communities. There is a gap with local level and local realities as challenges and priorities differ and vary across communities. Civic education programs should incorporate local examples and stories to enhance relevance and encourage active engagement at the local level. Monitoring and evaluation on the impact of the civic education program needs to happen regularly to measure the effectiveness of the programs and identify areas for improvement and relevance, so the communities will always relate to the goal and how it benefits them. I believe that looking at and considering these gaps will help contribute to the effective implementation of the SDG goal and strengthen civic education. As a result, we will empower people, especially youths, who contribute to the peaceful communities and progress towards achieving SDG 16. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lakawa, for that amazing presentation, but also for the work that you've done and continue to do in empowering our youth. It is sincerely appreciated. So thank you very, very much. Now I'd like to take this opportunity to re-remind everyone that if you have questions, we will address them after our final speaker. However, if you'd like, you may post these questions in the chat feature now, which will be addressed later. Join our second speaker of the day, Isitirunga Ray Baisesi. Ray is of Banaban and Kiribati descent and was born in Fiji and raised in both Fiji and Kiribati. He holds a diploma in business accounting from the Fiji National University and Bachelor of Social Work with honors from Massey University from Auckland, New Zealand. He has been a climate and human rights advocate for 13 years and has voluntarily served his communities in Kiribati, New Zealand, and Fiji. Ray has undertaken various community research in the areas of human rights, climate change, and so forth. He also sits on regional and international boards representing the Pacific. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Baisesi, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Amelia. I'm just trying to sort out my camera, but it won't go on. It was on when I first joined the call, but just played up. To acknowledge the traditional owners of the land where Brisbane is located, the Turrbal and Yungara peoples. And also acknowledge the rest of, colleagues and panelists, as well as the organizers recording all of this, for also having us to share. I hope from your end.
I'm sorry, Ray, your audio seems to be cutting in and out.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, that's better. Thank you. Sorry, Ray, are you still with us?
So do you see my screen?
I'm sorry, Ray, you keep your audio keeps dropping in and out. If I may, can I please ask you to start again, if that's okay?
Amelia,
yes, that's better.
Okay, so I'll do it without my presentation, I think, and without my video as well, because when I share my screen, the network kind of just cut it off.
Of course, we understand.
A very good morning to everyone. My name is Ray, as Amelia shared. And, I've spent 13 years of my life working and serving my communities in different parts of the Pacific Islands, notably working and advocating on climate change, human rights, trying to empower women through, community action on programs, supporting women on the ground, supporting implementation of other projects to address cultural heritage, loss and damage and all other work. I'm originally from Barnaba, and Barnaba is in the modern day Kiribati. And I am a third generation young person that was displaced and uprooted from my ancestral home of Barnaba to Fiji, which is 2,000 kilometers away, because of extractive industries that destroyed our homeland and made it uninhabitable. Growing up as a young person, I've always had this very deep connection with home, because our elders and our communities celebrate the anniversary of our arrival in Granby in 1945, December 15, 1945. And this becomes the annual celebration just to recall, share stories of our displacement, as well as share stories of resilience and how we've transitioned to make Granby our new home. So in terms of context, if you're not sure about what happened to Barnaba, and I'm sorry that I cannot share these the presentation with you, but I can hand it over to Amelia to share it after. But what happened to our people was as a result of the British Phosphate Company that acquired our island since the 1900s. And the three stakeholders to the British Phosphate Commission was Australia, New Zealand, and the UK. And for 80 years, they mined our islands. And as a result, they had to get rid of the indigenous people through relocating them to an island they bought in Fiji through their phosphate royalties. I grew up in Granby, but I also migrated back to Kiribati in 2004. I was born in Lombasa, and growing up as a young person, I've always had the, you know, question of identity and, you know, where do I come from? And this question started rising when I was in high school, just having the self-doubt about who am I in the bigger majority group. But we've also transitioned to be part of the bigger community groups, but it still remained the question of identity and in our new home. When we went back to Kibas in 2004, I thought I was going back home, because that's where Barnaba is located. I went to school in Kiribati the first year. It's that question of identity that started coming up again, because I thought I was home, yet I was being coiled and labeled a Rambian, a Fijian, or an Ikiribes who have lived in Rambi. And, you know, that for me was the drive to the work that I do. Being a displaced young person and a product of that displacement because of the injustice that was caused to our islands made me, you know, realize that, you know, the things that our ancestors, the history of our people, you know, should become a lesson learned for everyone, every other communities that may have to be displaced because of climate change in the future. So I started working in Kiribati in 2011 in the Kiribati Local Government Association, and I served all the rural and urban councils of Kiribati for 4 years, working to support capacity building programs as well as development programs for the island councils. And that's where I really developed my love and passion for community service and community work. During my 4 years of service for the local government association, Kilga, I then resigned and worked with young people on a volunteer basis. And these were very capable, young, aspiring artists that were singing in cover bars and, you know, trying to earn income from their talents. So what I basically did is we formed a group of, you know, what we call Kiribati Children Campaigners Network. Then we started utilizing their skills and, you know, the music to sing about climate change, anti-corruption, all other issues that young people were going through, you know, and what they were experiencing as part of that, you know, social issues that young people have to face or are facing on a daily basis. But what happened in the process is that we tried and get young people to talk with the president at the time. It was President Anote Tong. And then later on, we were able to get 20 young people to the Marshall Islands to formulate a group on the Coalition of Atoll Nations on Climate Change. And we were very successful to bring our young people to the meetings, some COP meetings and everything else. And then later on, we also established the Kiribati Island Corruption Kickers Network. And we started developing civic education material and also developing posters and cartoons on the different types of corruption, and started just going out to the community to educate them on the importance, you know, why generation, how do you analyze manifestos within given government parties, and so forth. Then I went to New Zealand to study, and then I also started some work with our Kiribati and Barnaban communities in New Zealand. And basically, it was around digitizing resources. And so while Kiribati was also talking about climate change and what do they do with their people, you know, around migration and building resilience, there was a high number of, or influx number of Kiribati communities that were already in New Zealand for economic reasons. And in New Zealand, we also tried and support a local NGO who works with the Kiribati and Tuvalu communities on navigating policy and you know, legal spaces around implementing their human rights as communities who are displaced there, and how they can access well-being support services while they're there. I was in New Zealand for 5 years, and I support the work there with the communities that have migrated. Then I also came back to Rambi. This time I came back in 2021, and when I left Fiji in 2004, I felt personally that nothing has changed a lot when I came back. I still came back to drinking brown water. I still came back to having to travel 80 kilometers away to Savo Savo to access better health services. I still have to travel to Savo Savo to, to do shopping and all these other stuff. And much of the experiences that I had as a young person really, really drove me to say, how can we help, after 77 years of displacement, our elders came into, our elders were in Fiji since 1945. And, I was really trying to figure out what's happening, why there hasn't development or any changes on the island. And so I embarked on a journey of research as a volunteer in Rambi, supporting the communities, and we published so many reports after 2 years, and that has been the informations that I use now to implement and to do most of the work that I'm doing in Rambi. And so there was a people called the Barnaban Rambi Rehabilitation Initiative in 2021, which focuses on rehabilitation using the social work perspective on how do we rehab displaced communities that are already very experiencing trauma, historical trauma because of the injustice that was caused to them, and the way that they were moved. And so in 2010, I partnered with the International Center Advocates Against Discrimination, and we kind of designed a project called the Right to Life with Dignity Project, and to do a community consultation to collect stories from our remaining elders who are on Rambi, and then to also develop a policy brief on the dispossession and displacement of Barnaban policy, a policy brief on dispossession and displacement of Barnabans. In 2022, we developed a activism project to implement the kind of finding that we found after the consultation and developing the policy brief. And it was just so awful that, there were so many human rights violations that took place in the process of our forced relocation. And no wonder we still inherit those, deficit social well-being indicators in all our well-being domains, such as health. Rambi is basically number one in the rural area, top of every deficit health. High youth unemployment, lack of development, and so forth. So we developed the policy brief, and then we started working because in terms of context, the Barnabans are governed, well, self-autonomous, partly semi-self-autonomous. We have our own Barnaban Settlement Act within the Fiji government. We also have an act in the Kiripes government. We have two MPs in the Kiripes parliament, and we have a chapter within the Kiripes constitution that also look after the well-being and welfare of our Barnaban people. Now, this Colonial Settlement Act was a provision that was entrenched within the two constitution of the two states to look after the affairs of the Barnaban people. But right now, with a lot of loopholes and gaps within the two constitutions in two states, the life and the affairs of the Barnaban people is very political. And that was why we angled this work with our young people to say that, you really need to be present in this democracy work, because our history is so much political because of that historical context and the displacement that moved us. But some of the key challenges that I came about working in Kiribati, New Zealand, in Rambi, it's the question of as a young person, it's the question of, do I know my human rights? And I think in Kiribati, on the work that we do on climate change and anti-corruption, one of the most prominent issues that I came up with was cultural obstacles. And then we need to navigate these, especially if you're an advocate for your country and for the the things that you stand for your country as a young person, your cultural competency, your worldview on how you see things. You really need to groom yourself or build capacity to ensure that whatever you do is not disrespectful to the elders and to the spaces that you work in communities. And then also politicizing the issue of climate change within the scope of politics, where migration with dignity was something that was supported by a previous government, and then the new government came in to support resilience building. And then you have young people who are floating between political ideologies and systems that governments bring in on a different time, space, and location. That was another major challenge that young people were confronted with. In New Zealand, where you're looking at the Kiribati youth and migration in that context, youth exploitation, and lack of support system for youth migrants. Majority of our young people who are migrating to New Zealand are young people. And so they're faced with a lot of exploitation, not just on the Kiribati group, but other Pacific Island groups. And if you have followed, there's been so many articles that came out because of these exploitation. And then coming back to Rambi, where a colonial settlement net that is already so very old and not working for our development. How do we engage young people to talk about these issues? And we were so fortunate that we were part of the Reimagining Democracy workshop that was just that was held a few weeks back in Suva, and we talked about Barnaban issues and why the settlement net is not working. Why is it that our Fiji government, the coalition government, has promised us to reinstate the council, but yet they're not working towards that pathway? And we had to raise that as young people, because of course the local government is the closest stakeholder to the development of people, and they live and breathe with communities, yet they will not allow us to go into election next year because our channel as a displaced community, as a minority community in Fiji, does not fit with the whole plan around reinstating this council. And then of course falling in the crack of two countries, and I've shared that our well-being domains are just so deficit and so worrying that we need to really help our young people, and helping them in a way that they could participate. And to be frank, as a young person myself, I had to be creative with my approach of engaging young people to turn up to consultations in the community, to turn up to consultations in local government, to turn up to consultations in national, regional, international spaces. Young people are not, and I have to be really honest, young people are afforded the space but are not attending and are not taking a lot of interest in participating in all these spaces that are set up for them. Lack of research and perhaps lack of understanding. Foremost is, how do we make information very friendly and very accessible to young people? And no wonder young people do not turn up to very important consultations to participate and also to share their views on what they think they feel about issues that are being discussed. Lack of policy interventions, of course, because young people are not turning up. They cannot be a stakeholder or an important stakeholder in the policy stages of developing those policies that will address youth issues, but yet they complain at the end of the day that they're being used as tokens. And then lack of legislations across Kiribati, New Zealand, Barnabans. There is lack of legislations to actually deal with these issues of that are being politicized around the issues of climate change, anti-corruption, migration, displacement. We need to be present on these spaces, because only then can all our issues be addressed. And of course, young people lack access to human rights resources, especially in the beautiful indigenous languages that we have. You cannot be bringing materials that are not understood by a specific group of people, because they need to access those documents to make informed decisions so that they are able to participate and also implement the human rights as citizens and good citizens of any country. Then, of course, lack of financial support to support very deep that young people are changing in their different countries. The last issue that I want to talk about, which also becomes a challenge, is ensuring how young people can participate in internal and regional spaces. the young person educators in the PIF space, regional spaces, international space, you know, how we navigate our way to understand where this conversation starts, where the conversation needs to work in. It still become a very consolidated experience for many of young people. This is because young people have been volunteering. They've been volunteering and very busy in the community. And this idea of volunteering for young people in the past, we really looked at, because we cannot be volunteering for very, very important issues. And just thank you for offering national, regional, international perspective. I've been involved in this work. Thank you very much, Compassion Drapa, and happy you are.
Thank you very much, Ray, for your incredible presentation. We sincerely appreciate the time that you took to be with us here this morning. Now, there were moments where your presentation was kind of dropping in and out. So I'll just remind all of our participants that a little later on, if you'd like to ask him any questions, or if you'd like to go back and ask him to kind of maybe recover some of the things that you may have missed, we can do that in the question and answer session. Now, in the meantime, if you'd like, you may go ahead and pose the questions that you do have, or if there's anything that you'd like to kind of highlight, you can go ahead and do that in the chat feature. And these will all be addressed a little later on in the question and answer session. Now, last but certainly not least, our final speaker for today, Epeli Lesuma from Pacific Network on Globalization. Now, Epeli Lesuma is from Vakondrove and graduated with a Bachelor of Commerce in Politics and Management from the University of the South Pacific. Upon graduating, he served for several years in various roles of the Fiji Higher Education Commission before joining the Pacific Network on Globalization in 2022. He initially joined to provide search support for their nuclear justice program before being appointed as their nuclear justice campaigner. He's also been a dedicated volunteer and member of the Fiji Red Cross Society for nearly a decade, contributing at the governance level to the youth program and both constitutional and strategic reforms. Mr. Lesuma, thank you so much for joining us today. Over to you.
Thanks. Thank you, Amelia. Perhaps just to ensure I'm coming across clearly for everyone, maybe just give me a thumbs up reaction on Zoom. Well, let me know if everyone can hear me clearly before I start proper. All right, I saw one thumbs up. Thank you. So Bulavinak, everyone, as Amelia had explained, my name is Epeli, and I work supporting the Pacific Network on Globalization's nuclear justice campaign. And so perhaps before I head into it, a bit of a brief on who PANG is as an organization. We are a regional Suva-based civil society organization that support a wide range of networks, some indigenous communities, feminist groups, youth groups, academics and activists and artists, to promote economic self-determination, political self-determination for Pacific peoples. A large part of our role is to serve as a think tank organization as well, to provide advice, be it legally or politically, using our network for Pacific people to advocate for their self-determination at either a national, regional, or international level. And in the nuclear justice program that I work with specifically, we support a network of groups in Pacific Islands nuclear affected communities. So these communities are in the Marshall Islands, in Mauhi Nui or French-occupied Polynesia. And this also includes those from Christmas Island, Kiribati, both the affected communities in Kiribati, but also veteran communities as well, and advocating for nuclear justice issues for the Pacific and for these people at various levels. And so my talk today, I was asked to speak briefly on around three things. And I don't have a presentation, but I hope you'll be able to draw some gold nuggets out of what I'll share. So the first area, I really enjoyed listening to the first two presentations just quickly. And the highlighted points around the challenges that young people face, given that this year's International Day of Democracy theme is around empowering the next generation, highlight the challenges that Vinyana and Ray both highlighted around engaging young people, you know, rural and peri-urban or displaced communities, engaging them in various processes of consultation, and the challenges they face around access to resources and information. I think this is a challenge that various organizations face at one point or another, tying it to the work that I did with the volunteer work I do with the Fiji Red Cross, listening to some of the challenges Ray and Vinyana highlighted were ones that I was familiar with in terms of getting young people on board and having them a part of change. But we're talking about democracy today, and young people are a key part of achieving democracy, particularly here in the Pacific, where we make up the majority of the population. In relation to nuclear justice and the program that I work with, young people have played an important role in advocating for nuclear justice issues, and taking on the mantle and the stories passed on to them by their elders to campaign for countries like France, the United States, and the United Kingdom to properly acknowledge and compensate affected communities here in the Pacific. One such youth group that has perhaps been, that we work with at PANG, that has been an active voice for nuclear justice in the Pacific is one called Young Solwara Pacific. And Young Solwara Pacific is a collective of artists, academics, who use art as a medium to advocate for nuclear justice, but also advocating for other issues such as self-determination for occupied Pacific countries like West Papua. And so Young Solwara's ability to position art as a form of engagement with young people and as a form of messaging to a global audience is one of the ways in which PANG has worked with youth to sort of engage in maybe discussions like democracy, discussions like nuclear justice, discussions like the Fukushima nuclear wastewater issue that may be slightly sensitive in other spaces. And so the beauty in using art is that it's able to transcend a number of spaces, be it in a university or a school, or in church spaces, or religious spaces rather, but also entering the public domain, social media, city streets, and art galleries and museums. Young people have an important role as well when you think about being the bridge, I suppose, between one generation to the next. And so in doing some reading about why youth are important in democracy and in campaigns like nuclear justice, A word that stood out for me is that young people are the bridge to the future. There's often talk about young people being the leaders of tomorrow. And so the importance of involving them in advocacy work today is it takes on new meaning, because in involving young people in talking about Fukushima issues today, you set them up to be better leaders when they sit in leadership positions in the future. And ensuring that they continue to impart knowledge to a new generation of nuclear justice campaigners. Young people have played an important role in as recently as 2 or 3 weeks ago, where if you had the opportunity to participate and see videos or photos from the Fukushima anti-wastewater dumping march in Suva, there were a cross-section of people that participated in that march. They weren't just older folks who were protesting in the 70s and the 80s, but there were also a few children in school uniform that participated. There were young people that also, young families who brought their children along. And so it was encouraging to see a seed being planted in the lives of these children on the importance of speaking up for what they believe in and what they see as something worth protecting. And in the case of the Fukushima protest march, it was the Pacific Ocean. I think it was an acknowledgement by their parents and who brought them along or gave consent for them to be there, that this march that took place 3 weeks ago was so much more than colorful placards and shouting. It was a call to action for the leaders now to be conscious of the decisions being made that will impact these young folk further down the line. And so when I think about democracy and the journey of democracy that Fiji has undergone, that Fukushima march for me was an exciting one, because it was one where you saw Fijians have the opportunity to march and express a view vocally and passionately for something that they believe in. But it was also exciting for Fiji's democracy because you saw a new generation of ocean activists, marine conservationists, and nuclear justice campaigners. And so in and amongst the midst of the doom and the gloom of young people perhaps not engaging more effectively or not accessing resources, I think that march was a small representation of how democracy, this intersection between democracy and nuclear justice, can sort of lead to a new generation of nuclear justice campaigners or democracy campaigners at that. What I've observed as well, being an avid social media user, has been the vibrancy of discussions that have been taking place, not only about this issue around Fukushima and Japan's wastewater release, nuclear wastewater release, but also the young people that have actively participated in maybe tagging a member of parliament on Twitter or Facebook. And asking hard questions. They don't always get the response from their leader in government, but it's encouraging to see that the questions are being asked, that critical thought is being generated. What I acknowledge though in saying this is that a lot of the young people that perhaps engage actively on social media and in these conversations around Fukushima and democracy are young people who have the privilege of accessing maybe stable internet, smartphone device, and also perhaps maybe to a certain extent information. And so Vinyana's presentation was an interesting one because there are gaps that exist between young people in the rural settings and young people in the urban settings and access to mediums like this through Zoom. So how then do we bridge this gap for young people in various settings and contexts? I think perhaps it becomes incumbent upon us as maybe urban-based young people to be better advocates for and mentors for, perhaps even the voice for at times, rural-based young people. And so that was the encouragement that I found in Ray's intervention, for example, because coming from Rambi, going back to Kiribati and now studying in Australia and in New Zealand separately, he's been able to be a better voice for young people, talking in his talking about climate change, for example. And so for us, when we talk about nuclear justice, it requires, I guess, a greater level of responsibility and custodianship, I suppose, for us to always be conscious that in talking about issues like Fukushima, it's important that we're also able to explain and share information with our friends in the rural areas and rural settings. One of the questions that is also asked of me to speak on, rather, was around Fukushima nuclear justice and its link to SDG 5 on gender equality and SDG 16 on peace, justice, and strong institutions. Just in relation to SDG 5, I oftentimes decisions are made by men in power, and having the opportunity to attend the Democracy Reimagined Symposium that CCF hosted, I think about a month ago, this was a message that resonated, I suppose, with me and came out very strong in an intervention made by Ms. Noli Nambulivo from Diva for Equality. And so when I thought about this Fukushima wastewater release, you sort of unpack and realize that it's a decision that is taken by Japanese government, of which their prime minister is a man, and the decisions to support the IAEA's report, and similarly Japan's stance in Fiji's case is another decision taken by a man. And so the link, I suppose, between environmental harm, perhaps harm on our and domination of men in our democracy, is one that perhaps does not unpack to really understand the impact that it has on women and children. And so Fukushima's wastewater release and the concerns that people have emanate from the impact that it will have on food sources, economic opportunities, with many people relying on the fish for an income through the sale of seafood and things like that, but also the impact on families and the health of mothers, women, and children. And so it's encouraging to see that in the case of our nuclear march in the last 2 weeks, that was a march where one of the leading groups were feminist groups and women from communities in the West that largely rely on the sea for their source of income, but also to put food on the tables of their families. And so the passionate pleas that came across about, changing the stance of Fiji government's support for the IAEA's and Japan's release of wastewater into the ocean was one that I think was quite memorable for many of us who may have attended that much. But also, I'm also reminded of a group in Japan. They call themselves the Fukushima mums who have volunteered to sort of test the water that is being discharged out of Fukushima. And these mums do so acknowledging the impact that this wastewater will have on their children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. And I think that, if anything, is a good example of how women have taken charge of the opportunity to to become actively engaged in voicing concerns as part of a democratic process, but also actively engaged in this science and this debate of whether this wastewater is safe or not, against the science of which is largely dominated by men. Circling maybe, you know, I'm conscious of time, to the last two points that I've just jotted down as well. Democratic spaces and unpacking why youth and independent institutions are important. I think conversations like this, webinars like this, are a great start for generating discussions on why we need to be better advocates for a healthy democracy, better advocates in turn for things that impact our democracy, like nuclear waste in the Pacific, and lack of youth and gender participation and representation. And so online platforms like this are a great way to start those conversations about why you and I as voters and as taxpayers need to speak up actively. But I think I'm conscious as well that in speaking to those on this call and those that may watch this call, that I'm probably already speaking to the converted. And so it becomes incumbent on all of us going back after this call to whatever spaces we may retreat back to after this, to also have the same conversations with our families around the dinner table or friends around the tano maybe, about why it is important to cherish and defend our democracy, and why it is important to access information that perhaps we, when we don't know enough about something. And I think, you know, it's encouraging that we have an organization like CCF in Fiji, where we're then able to make connections and access information in a manner that is palatable for young people, palatable as well for young women, and young people, you know, depending on whether they're in a peri-urban setting or in a rural setting as well. I think another way that we can perhaps also become active in engaging in our democracy is through the media and through social media. And so I see, in terms of practicing what I preach, I do this by tweeting as actively as I do. Part of being in a vibrant democracy is also calling out behavior that is perhaps inappropriate. And so how I practice this every day is by tweeting government number plates, for example, government drivers that drive dangerously on the road. I walk to and from work daily. And so when you walk as I do, you tend to observe very reckless driving by our blue number plated vehicles in government. And so one of the ways in which I maybe try, it's a small way at least, to engage in my democracy as a young person is to tweet the number plate of the driver and call them out for their driving. Perhaps the next step for me, and maybe the next step for you as a small example, is writing to the government minister or ministry to LTA to say, these are the drivers driving unsafely on our roads, and they need to be pulled into line. So engaging, I suppose, I use that as an example, I suppose, as engaging on social media, perhaps even writing letters to the editor, to hold our democracy and those that we put in power to account, but also to demonstrate that it's okay to call bad behavior out, and it's incumbent upon us as voters to actively do this, that the time of silence in our country, I think, is over. And the only way for us to create a vibrant democracy and to empower our next generation is if we you know, do it and practice what we preach. I'm not going to take up any more time, but I thank you. I hope I was able to come across clearly for everyone and maybe implant some little nuggets of gold. But I'll hand over to Amelia now, Hinaka.
Thank you so much, Ifeli, for that amazing presentation. I really enjoyed hearing what you had to say. Also to our two other speakers, Ms. Viniana Thakau and Mr. Isiserunga Ray by Cecia. Now, we now have about 10 minutes for our question and answer session. So if there's anyone, if there's a question you'd like to ask, you could always post in the question and answer chat group or chat function, or you can raise your hand. I'd like to encourage all of you to use this opportunity to ask our panelists questions. Now, if there's a specific person that you'd like to address this question to, please indicate so, or otherwise you may let the panelists know that it's an open question for all three of them. Now, I know that was a lot of information to take in, so I'll just give you a few moments to type your questions into the chat box or to raise your hand if you'd like to ask any of our panelists a question. All right, okay, so no questions so far, that's fine. I know that was a lot of information to absorb, so to get the questions started, I guess I have an observation and also a question. It's really maybe for all three of you. Apparently you said something earlier that really stuck with me, and that was, if I'm speaking to you, then I'm already kind of speaking to the converted, and I love that. You know, a lot of times when we're in these situations, when we're in these presentations, we're really kind of speaking to people who have already kind of heard the gospel. How do we encourage those people who need to be coming to these tables? How do we encourage youths, for example, who might be interested, but you know, because we're kind of taught from a young age to be seen and not to be heard, how do we get them to kind of go against the grain and to start joining these groups, to have a voice? And I'd really like to hear from all three of you, seeing that all three of you've kind of worked in different facets of the youth community. So I'm not sure who'd like to go first in answering that, but Apelli, since your camera's already on, I guess you could go first.
Sure, I'm happy to, because I have a great example of how I was able to maybe convert someone in about the 21st of August. The Pacific Youth Council had a International Youth Day celebration at the Holiday Inn, done in coordination with the UN agency. And there were a number of young people there, mostly, I think, university students. And once the formalities had ended, three young people flooded to our booth, Tang's booth. And on our table, we displayed information on our nuclear justice program, freedom for West Papua and self-determination, but also our call for a ban on deep sea mining. And two of the young ladies in particular had a lot of questions about Fukushima. They had only heard about the issue, had a relative understanding of why it's bad and its impacts. But I used that opportunity to sort of maybe convert them and turn them into hopefully active participants in our democracy and nuclear justice advocates. Fast forward 2 weeks later, when we marched through Suva, towards the end of the demonstration marches, when we were in front of Parliament House, I got a tap on my shoulder. And when I turned around, it was the young lady who I had spoken to 2 weeks prior, proudly wearing her anti-nuclear t-shirt and proudly saying she was happy and proud to have participated in that march. So I suppose for me that was a small win in maybe converting someone, as you know, to use that word, to not only become a nuclear justice advocate, but also an active participant in her democracy. That as a young second year law student from Bifinu, she was able to march an expressive view on the streets of Suva. So that's just my small example of speaking to the converting someone. To answer your question, Amelia Naka.
That is such an amazing story. Thank you so much. Viviana, Ray, would you like to share your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, from our end, sorry, Viviana, but from my end, you know, over the last days, the last few days, the last week, you must be aware of, you know, the fact that a mining company has resurfaced once again to try and remind our home island in Kiribati, and done to resist this work. We have been engaging the media, and I think deploying other means where we can actually amplify the voices of our communities who are landowners who have never been consulted prior to the, you know, I think one effective way of bringing people on board is to try and break down information. And we do this by putting resources for our communities and also translating it to the Tete and Kiribati, which is the language that we use because our Bantu language was lost in the process of our migration story. So petitions and, you know, young people and the general community can only join if they really understand, you know, the angle and the framing to the level, to, you know. So that was one way we could work around this campaign. And this campaign is an ongoing one. We're still trying to present the petitions. Plus, with the lack of awareness of our people, they've been threatened, you know, that petitions is illegal and anyone who signs the petition can get in trouble. But most of our communities are, you know, when you tell them their human rights, we need to educate them and break down these human rights so that they understand it to the level that they you know, they're well prepared to join any specific courses. Thank you. And I'll pass it on to Vinian.
Okay, one approach that CCF is currently using is a continuous intervention and engagement of youth. So we have it in phases. First, it's education and awareness in communities, and then we identify youths who are interested in the content, interested in human rights and the 2013 Constitution or the rule of law. And then we take them further or engage them further in symposiums and other workshops, like the one that we had last month, where Ray and Epeli were part of. We invited youths from Tavua, from Nandi, who were part of our community workshops. Just because they generated an interest during our workshops in the communities, we invited them to the symposiums for peer discussions, for them to further explore ways on how they can enhance their learning on democratic principles. So those are some of the things, one of the approaches that CCF is continuing and will continue to do. Now that we are working in upper urban areas, recently we have started to move away from the Itoke villages, not just because we want to concentrate on peri-urban, but we want to keep a balance to sort of see how the youths are managing in rural areas and also how youths in the peri-urban areas are involving themselves, are being engaged. So we can have a collaborative approach, as I have mentioned in my presentation, to have a collaborative approach with relevant ministries, civil societies, and organizations who are keen to work with you, to work with youth and look at how they can be developed and maybe sustain living to minimize the crime rate or lessen the crime rate, or have support networks in the communities. So those are some of the things that the Citizens Constitution Forum is currently doing in NAFCA.
Thank you so much, Vinyana, and thank you so much, everyone, for answering those questions. Now, if you have any other questions, I'm going to have to ask that you send them in. We've ran out of time, and we just have a few minutes left for closing remarks for everyone. So I'm going to ask that our speakers kind of gather their thoughts so you can deliver your closing remarks. But in the meantime, I'd like to extend our appreciation to all of you for being here this morning to participate in today's webinar. And when we opened up this morning's webinar, there was a sentence that I read out that I lifted from the website of International IDEA, and it read, "Education is a powerful tool for empowering young people and fostering their active engagement in democratic processes." And I couldn't agree more. I firmly believe that education is the key to success, and that coupled with information can allow us and them to make smart, informed choices. Now, with those few words, we're going to go from back to front. Mr. Lesuma, if you'd like to give your closing remarks now, please. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Amelia. I suppose in closing, my final comment to everyone is, I suppose, to actively, you know, we're engaging here actively. I'd like to throw a challenge back to the audience to actively perhaps have conversations about our democracy and how we as voters and taxpayers can maybe contribute to making it stronger and more robust, to hold our leaders to account, but also actively looking at opportunities of how we can maybe learn from each other and collaborate. And so if this webinar is one useful way in which we can disseminate information, I'd encourage the audience and challenge the audience to share the video once it's out, if it comes out, to two friends, so that we can start having more serious conversations about this sort of thing. And other than that, happy International Day of Democracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lesuma. And thank you very much for the work that you do with and for the Pacific Network on Globalization. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Baisesi to give us his closing remarks, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amelia. In closing, I'd like to thank the organizers for bringing us into this very important space. From my perspective, there is a lot to be done in advancing democracy for indigenous in any specific context, whether you are in New Zealand, Australia, Kiribati, or anywhere in any part of the world. The story of the Barbarians has been one of the most important story, because we still pretty much controlled under and democracy was so broken. If you have networks or just more towards addressing the challenges, the legal challenges about facing, you know, open to discussing these with partners like IDEA, CCF, who can actually be that supporting institution to advance the rights of Indigenous people. Thank you very much, and thank you everyone for participating in today's plenary. Now.
Thank you very much, sir, for all the work that you do, but especially for joining us this morning all the way from Canberra. We sincerely appreciate it. And last but not least, Ms. Lakao, would you like to give your closing remarks?
I'll share the same sentiments as Ebele and Ray in terms of upholding democracy, since I can tell that who are all on this Zoom are all the converted. So how do we reach out to the ones who are not converted? So I guess it's a lot on us, and CCF does a lot of civic education. This is a good platform where we can reach out to one another, where we can work collaboratively, since we work on different issues, on climate change, global climate change. I guess this is a platform that we can all share information, because there's capacity already on this space that we can sort of complement to reach out to those that we need to reach out to accelerate the progress of democracy and strengthen democracy here in Fiji. Lunaka.
Thank you so much, Ms. Takao. And thank you very much for availing yourself this morning. We sincerely thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us here today. And not just to you, Madam, but to our other two panelists as well. Gentlemen and Madam, on behalf of International IDEA Fiji and International IDEA Asia and our Pacific Regional Office, we'd like to thank you sincerely for sharing your knowledge and experience with us today. We'd also like to thank you, our audience, for joining us for this live event. And just using Mr. Lesuma's earlier shared experience as an example, you never know when a seemingly random conversation, a shared moment can make a difference, can give someone the courage they need to be an advocate for change. So if I had one ask, it's to use those moments you have to make them learning opportunities. What we say, what we share, what we do can make a difference and encourage the next generation of leaders. And as Ms. Bakau asked, how can we reach the unconverted? A question to ponder as we finish today's webinar. Now, if you enjoyed this webinar, then we'd like to strongly encourage you to look out for the dates for our next one. And we, as always, we look forward to your participation. Until then, from the International IDEA team, from CCF and I, Vinakavakalevu and Nisamodemanga.